how long can low-yielding bonds deliver better returns than some of America's highest quality blue-chip companies, which have dividends offering competitive yields and a history of increasing dividends every year? And that is the question this week's great investor guest, Hersh Cohen, will answer. Hersh recently retired as the co-manager of the Partners Appreciation Fund, which he ran for 31 years, first at Smith Barney, then at Legg Mason Clearbridge Advisors. The fund was named to the exclusive Forbes Honor Roll 8 times, and Hersh was a finalist for Morningstar's Equity Fund Manager of the Year in 2008. He is now Chief Investment Officer of Clearbridge Advisors and co-manages its Equity Income Builder and Dividend Strategy Funds. Now, Hersh rarely appears on television and only does so when he feels he has an important story to tell. I asked him why now is one of those times.
I think that there's a powerful opportunity that is generally being ignored, and that is in these high quality, I'll call them blue chip stocks, but high quality companies with high returns on equity, low debt levels, where the dividends are not only currently high in relation to all other asset categories, but we think sustainable and possibly growing. Many of them have history of growing for long periods of time. And I've not seen a period when these stocks are as cheap as they are relative to fixed income securities, relative to other kinds of securities, since probably the early 1980s.
One of the benchmarks that you've mentioned to me earlier was that the fact that a lot of these stocks have dividend yields that are higher than the dividend than the yield, the interest rate yield on the 10-year Treasury
Many of them.
And that is an unusual occurrence, correct?
In my memory, the last time I saw that, and I wasn't in the market yet, although some people would say I wouldn't, I wasn't in the market yet, was the mid-50s. And the mid-50s, since from the Depression until the late 1950s, stocks always yielded more than bonds because they were thought to be a riskier asset category. And when the great bull market of 1949 began, finally it dawned on people that stocks maybe weren't as risky, and so you had this crossover of the stock-bond yield spread, and it never looked back. And Now you actually have it again. Now, you could argue our Treasury is artificially depressed.
Well, are they?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
But does it matter?
No. Because you ask yourself, would you rather own a 10-year Treasury yielding, call it 3%, even though as we're recording this, it's under that, for the next 10 years, where you know you're going to get your money back and you get 3% a year, would you rather own Exxon? Would you rather own Johnson & Johnson? Would you rather own Walmart? Would you rather own Travelers Insurance? Would you rather own Procter & Gamble? Would you rather own 3M? All of whom have increased their dividends on a consistent basis and are yielding anywhere from 2.5% to 4.25%. Kimberly Clark, 4.25% dividend. Heinz, 4% dividend. Are they going to be here 10 years from now? Yeah. Are the dividends going to be higher? I strongly believe so. There's a history of raising dividends there. Kimberly Clark just raised the dividend 10% this year. I mean, there's a whole list of these things. The companies have raised their dividend 10%. I have a little cheat sheet in my pocket in case I forget, but Procter & Gamble 10%, Johnson & Johnson 10%, all within the last few months. That's not a bad story.
So, Hersh,
it's a good story.
The kinds of companies that you're describing have had a great story of strong balance sheets and, you know, rising dividends for years. And they've been overlooked and undervalued. So why have they been overlooked, number one, and why will they be higher valued now?
There's so many reasons. I'm going to leave some out. But number one, there's been huge multiple compression. They haven't been as attractive in the past 10 years as they are now because the earnings have continued to grow for a lot of these companies. But the price earnings ratios of Walmart, for example, Walmart was, you know, 30 or 40 times earnings 15 years ago. Now they're going to earn $4 or plus or minus, you know, and the stock's 48, and they've raised their dividend every year since they've been public. It's not a bad story. So I don't think the average investor has the patience to wait for these things to play out. And the average investor wants overnight success. And so you get more and more momentum players. You get more and more fast traders. You get fewer and fewer investors. And investors are getting scared away. People who would normally buy these stocks and put them away like they might have done in the 1950s or 60s or even the second part of the 70s, they've gotten discouraged. They got beat up in the last decade. Mm-hmm. But if you look, it hasn't been a bad story. If you look at the last decade, S&P compounded negatively 2% a year in the decade, but I have a young fellow in our office who has gone back and looked at dividends in the last decade, and dividends compounded by his calculation 5.8% positively per year between 2000 and the end of 2009. And that's including the collapse of the financial stocks, none of which you'll notice that I've mentioned, with the exception of Travelers, which I don't really call a financial. So, but you know, there's no banks in here that in the list that you're going to be talking about later. And so it's the banks that all cut their dividends. It's a good story.